Ooh, y'all stand on your feet. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Goodness gracious. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Father. Hallelujah. Just let me give you this scripture and then let's pray. Goodness gracious. Luke chapter 22. Luke chapter 22 is where we're going to have to go this morning. Praise God. Luke 22, look at verse 39. Goodness gracious. Somebody else had a heartfelt prayer. And his name was Jesus. Praise God. Luke 22, 39 says this. He came out and went. He was into the Mount of Olives, and his disciples also followed him. When he was at the place, he said unto them, pray that ye enter not into temptation. He was withdrawn from them almost a stone's cast. He kneeled down and he began to pray, saying, Father, if you be willing, remove this cup from me. Nevertheless, everybody say nevertheless. Never say not my will, but thy will be done. It's what Jesus is saying to the Father. He's in a hard place. Anybody ever been in a hard place? Anybody ever been in a place they didn't really, really want to be, but you found yourself there anyway? He said, remove, Father, if you be willing, remove this cup from me. Nevertheless, not my will, but thine be done. And there appeared an angel unto him from heaven, strengthening him. Being in agony, he prayed more earnestly, and his sweat was as it were great drops of blood falling down to the ground. Lord, I thank you right now for your word. For your word is so powerful. Your word is just so true. There's no other truth but your word. You've given us your word. You've given us an example, Father. Lord Jesus, you've seen what it takes sometimes and the things we go through. And Lord, sometimes how we agonize and we pray, and it's as if we're sweating like Jesus, great drops of blood. We're interceding and praying for one another, trying so hard to do what you would have us to do, Father, when it becomes not our will, but your will. Lord, we ask right now that you would touch every heart, every mind, every soul. Fill this vessel with the Spirit of the living God. Just touch every heart that we would receive your word. We give you praise. We give you glory. We give you all the honor. And everybody says, amen. Let's give God a big old clap of praise, church. My Lord, my Lord, my Lord, my Lord, my Lord, my Lord. Oh, there's a presence up in here today. You can be seated. Praise God. Y'all want to... Stephanie, thank you so much, hon. Because that just confirmed what we need to be speaking up in here today. This might not be a hooping and a hollering message, amen? But it's not always about hooping and hollering. Sometimes it's just learning what God wants us to do in our lives, amen? Sometimes it's when we put ourselves aside, we go through what we got to go through, and we trust God in it, amen? That's all we can do, church, is trust God to work it out. Trust God to do it. When it comes to the place where we say, Lord, it's not my will, Lord, it ain't my will, it's your will. And we're asking your will to be done. How many can pray that even today? We want God's will done in our lives. Now, when you look at this scripture, I'll be hitting these verses just a little bit again. But it says that Jesus came. He went, he was in the Mount of Olives, and his disciples followed him. I wanted you to see, he's going, and this thing's a little hot. I don't know, is that better, y'all? I don't want nobody's ears to be hurting. But it says right here, I mean, I want to tell you something right here. A lot of times, we know we have a purpose. God has a purpose for our lives. But sometimes during that purpose, we find ourselves in places that we're not real comfortable with, that we don't really want to be in, okay? And sometimes it's as if we're wrestling with the Lord. Anybody ever wrestled with God? Anybody ever been in a place where you're just sort of wrestling? Let me tell you this, y'all. We wrestle with the will of God to be done in our lives. And even Jesus did that. So when you're wrestling with what God wants you to do, guess what? You're in good company. Because that's exactly what Jesus was doing right here in this bit of scripture. Let me tell you this. Abraham wrestled with God. Abraham was going to stab his son to death with a knife. Now, how many knows that when Abraham was going to kill his son, Isaac, as a sacrifice, that he had a word from God to do that? Yes. Somebody help me up in here. God told Abraham to take his son Isaac, offer him on the altar as a sacrifice. Yes. He had a word from the Lord. Now, this is important what I'm fixing to say, okay? So what Abraham is doing, church, he is obeying the word of the Lord. Lord, you told me, Father, you told me to sacrifice my son. I'm going to do what you told me to do. I'm going to take that son, I'm going to put him on the altar, and I'm going to take this knife, and I'm going to kill him. Because he's going to be that sacrifice. This is what Abraham is thinking in his heart, in his mind. Okay? Now, Abraham, here's what you've got to understand. This is what you really got to hear, though, today, y'all. If you don't get nothing else, get this. Abraham heard yet a proceeding word from the Lord. This is important. He heard a proceeding word. After this word that he's heard God say, Abraham, take your son, sacrifice him. All of a sudden, he hears a proceeding word. What do I mean by that, okay? If he had not heard the proceeding word from God, what do you think might would have happened? Now, the proceeding word I'm talking about is what Matthew 4:4 says. Matthew 4:4 says, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that what? Proceeds from the mouth of God. So there was the proceeding word that Abraham was hearing. He's ready to bring that knife down. He's ready to sacrifice his son. All of a sudden, here comes a proceeding word from the Lord. He says, Abraham, stay your hand. In other words, Abraham, don't kill your son. Don't sacrifice your son. See, you see what I'm saying? He's got a word from the Lord. Another word, a proceeding word. What would have happened if Abraham wasn't paying attention, listening to the Lord? Do we really think that God wanted Abraham to kill his son, to sacrifice his son? No, he did not. What was the intentions of the whole thing that God was doing for Abraham, y'all? He was trying to see if Abraham would just be obedient and do his will, God's will. And there's no way God would allow Abraham to kill his son because no man can die for another's sin. Somebody help me up in here. God says, wait a minute, Abraham. Your son ain't going to have to die. It's going to be my son that's going to die. It's going to be my son that's going to lay on that altar. It's going to be the Lamb of God who's going to pay the price for sin. Can I get amen up in here? Y'all still with me up in here? Y'all can shout and holler, it's fine, amen, praise God. Now look, so it's important, what I want you to see here, though, it's important for us to hear a proceeding word from God. God may tell you to do something, to see if you're going to be obedient. And then he might just come back, come on, and tell you something else. He wants to see if you're going to be obedient, all right? In other words, you don't need to go forward, you don't need to proceed until you get a sure word from God. Oh, Lord, help me up in here. Yeah, we could have never started this ministry until we got a sure word from God. Because this thing's too big for me. It's too big of a headache. It'd be too hard to carry. Can I get amen up in here? God has to carry. God has to do it. Amen. So Abraham got a proceeding word from God. He did not proceed. He stopped because he's got a sure word. How many realize we all in here need direction? Every one of us in here, we need direction. Lord, which way do you want us to go?
Yes.
Now, we see that Jesus, in verse 39, he came out and he went, as he was accustomed to do, to the Mount of Olives. Now, we're going to learn something in here, I hope, today, okay? Jesus is going to a place that he went to quite often, okay? Now, he went to the place. The reason he went to, there's two reasons why he went to this place, okay? And really, his place, and this is important, was a garden. It's called the Garden of Gethsemane. That's his place, okay? Two reasons why he's going to this place. One reason, the first reason is because this is a place of prayer. Everybody says a place of prayer. Everybody in here, you ought to have a place where you pray. Somebody help me up in here. I'm telling you, there needs to be a place that you just need to pray. Every morning I get up, y'all, my first step is I take a shower and get all that done, but my first step is I'm in my living room. Everybody's in bed. Nobody's up. And I'm in my living room praying. That's a place of prayer. And after I pray for a little while, some time, then I go out on the porch and I pray. Those are my places of prayer. I love to pray in the living room. When everybody's in bed and it's just me and the Lord, I like to get on my porch and I like to pray. And I like to speak things out because I feel like they're going up into the heavens. It's just something about being outside praying. So what I'm telling you, Jesus had a place of prayer. Everybody in here, you need a place of prayer. It's a place especially for you and the Lord. Number two, not only was it a place of prayer for Jesus, it was a time of prayer. He had a time of prayer. Don't raise your hand, doesn't matter, but how many in here, don't raise your hand, but how many in here has a time of prayer? Y'all, we need a set of time to pray. Some people say, well, I'm too busy to pray. I work. I work 12 hours a day. That's no excuse for me because I worked at BMW. I worked 12 hours a day, come on, and I was pastoring a church, and I still had time for prayer. Somebody help me up in here. So we don't have an excuse is what I'm saying. You have to make time. Jesus made time for prayer. Now, let me just tell you this. This is where the enemy really gets everybody. If you don't have a place and a time for prayer, you'll find yourself not praying. Amen. Come on. See, this is why this is important this morning, y'all. This is something you get in your spirit. You have to make time for that because God wants to talk to you. He wants to minister to you. He wants His will to be done in your life. So you have to pick out a time to pray. Come on. And a place to pray. And let me tell you, when you first begin to do that, you're going to have some battles. You're going to have the enemy trying to stop you. Everything's going to happen. The phone will be ringing off the hook. You'll get all kind of interruptions. But let me tell you this. You persevere. You don't quit. You continue on. And before you know it, it becomes natural for you. Nothing else will begin to happen because here you are. The devil knows he done lost that battle. You're going to pray. You got a time to pray and you got a place to pray. And there ain't nothing he can do to stop that. Somebody help me up in here because I don't care where I'm at, on vacation, wherever. I got a place and I got a time I'm going to pray. I remember we went to the men's conference. One of the men came up to me and said, "My Lord, you just inspired me so much." I said, "What are you talking about?" He said, "I was watching you. You was on your balcony just praying out to the Lord." And I said, "Well, praise God. I'm glad it inspired you, brother." He said, you just made me want to start praying again. He done got slack in praying. Y'all, it's important for us to pray. We got to pray for this ministry. How many pray for this ministry every day? I hope every one of you in here lift up this ministry, lift up this pastor. Guess what, y'all? I need your prayers. Amen. Dana needs your prayers. We need your prayers. Y'all getting our prayers every day. Can I get amen up in here? We're interceding, praying for y'all every day. But beyond that, guess who else is? Jesus is. And He's the greatest. Hallelujah. He's interceding. He's praying for every one of us every single day. He's praying for this ministry. He's praying for every family. And therefore, we just pray. We just try to line up with the head. Jesus is the head. Amen. And we begin to pray. We intercede. Now, look at this in verse 40 again. Let's look at some. Well, this we've already read scripture. I'm not going back to it. Okay. Sometimes, though, as you're praying, because, boy, we really want to get answered from God. Boom. Amen. We want it right then. Come on now. And we're wondering, God, what's wrong with you? You're not answering my prayer when I want you to. Come on. He don't have to work on your wants. He don't work on my wants. Come on, y'all. He works the way He wants to, and He does it at His time that He wants to. Amen. We just got to pray. Now, watch this. Sometimes you just got to sweat it out. Sometimes you just got to persevere. Billy Joe, this is for you, ain't it? Praise God, I'm telling y'all. Sometimes you just got to persevere. You've got to sweat it out. The Christian life, church, is not always easy. Boy, I didn't get no amens on that, did I? We think it's easy all the time. It's not. You got a boss man to give you a hard time sometimes. Somebody help me up in here. You got a lot of people to give you a hard time sometimes. It's not always easy. Okay? So what do we need to do? We need to pray. This is the first time, y'all, right here in this scripture, this is the first time we see the shedding of the blood of Jesus. Think about that. He's in the garden. Now, this is the first time that Jesus has shed His blood. We think it was all on the cross. We think Jesus shed His blood on the cross. This is the first time Jesus began to shed His blood. The blood of atonement did not start on Calvary, y'all. It started in Gethsemane. It started in a garden. Can I get amen up in here? Jesus began to shed His blood in a garden. Now watch this, y'all. He sweat. The Bible says in this text here, He sweat great drops of blood. Think about that for a minute. The Bible says Jesus, He was sweating great drops of blood. You remember sweat. Now, I want you to think about this for a minute. Think about it. Get this in your spirit. Sweat was part of the curse. Oh, Lord, help me up in here. Let me say it one more time. Sweat was a part of the curse. In fact, Genesis 17 says this, because, and this is God talking to Adam. He says, because you hearken to the voice of your wife, and not my voice, but the voice of another, in the sweat of your brow you shall eat. How many of the Lord said that? So Jesus, go, Lord, you got to put this together. Jesus was sweating great drops of blood, and actually, he was breaking the curse of Adam. Somebody help me up there. He was breaking that curse by sweating great drops of blood. Can you imagine what the Lord has done for us by the shedding of blood in the garden, interceding? So it don't matter what you're going through right now. It don't matter what you're facing right now, because Jesus has shed his blood in the garden. He's broken that curse, amen? He's broken everything and anything pertains to your life that's not like him. It's broken. And yet people want to live in a curse. Don't do it. Praise God. Give God the praise, glory, and honor. He's still in control. Amen. The enemy's not in control. God's in control. Amen. Yeah, I'm going through this thing, but it don't matter. God, you're in control. You're leading me. You're guiding me. You're interceding for me. You shed your blood. You started in the garden. And Lord, you finished it on the cross. Hallelujah. When you shed all of your blood on the cross. Glory. So no matter what I'm facing, no matter what I'm going through, the Lord is interceding for me. Amen. Can I get an amen? Now what you have tried to work out, and we all try to do that, we try to help God. Lord, I don't know about this. I don't want this. I don't want to go through this. But the Lord is saying, guess what? It's finished. I've paid the price. I wish we could get this in our spirit. Even when Jesus said it's finished, guess what? It's finished. Amen. The devil, really, he can't do anything to you. I mean, he can roar like a lion. He can do this. He can do that. But if you really get it in your spirit that it is finished, guess what? God's got you in the place he needs you to be. Lord, I know it's finished. You paid the price. We're going to win the victory. We are more than overcomers through the precious blood of Jesus. Lord, you are leading me. You are guiding me. It don't matter what position I'm in. It don't matter what condition I'm in. Lord, you are here for me. Hallelujah. You said it is finished. You defeated the devil. He's a defeated foe. Somebody help me up in here. He defeated him for you. We couldn't defeat the devil. So God says, I'm going to send my son. He'll defeat him for you. Hallelujah. Let me tell you this much. Jesus took your place and he paid the price. Now we got to do is learn to walk and trust in him. Amen. We learn to walk and to trust in the Lord no matter where we're at. Amen. We don't grumble. We don't complain. We just praise. Let me say it again. We don't grumble. We don't complain. We just praise. Lord, I praise you. Hallelujah. I want to be like Paul. Lord, I'm praising you with these 39 stripes on my back. Hallelujah. I want to give you the praise for everything. Glory. Glory. Can I get an amen up in here? Amen. Now, when he prayed in this scripture, in this text, the Bible says that there appeared an angel. In verse 43, that's what it says. When he prayed, an angel appeared. Can I tell you this? When you pray, angels are employed. You can't see them, but they're there. I promise you, there's angels up here right now, surrounded, each and every one of us. Amen. When Jesus began to pray, an angel came. When you and I pray, God sends his angels. Paul prayed in a storm, and guess what? An angel came. Daniel prayed in the den full of lions, and guess what? An angel came. Peter prayed in prison, and guess what? An angel came and unlocked the prison doors. My Lord, what a miracle that was. Can I get another amen? Samson prayed one last time, and he put his hands between those pillars and destroyed the enemies of the Lord. Amen. Angels came, y'all. God sends his angels when we begin to pray. The Bible says you have not because you ask not. Pray, 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 and pray. Bible says, ask and you shall receive, seek and you shall find, knock and it shall be opened unto you. But you got to have a time and you got to have a place to pray. Everybody thinks we just go supposed to come to church and pray. This is where it starts. This is where it's at. We do pray here. It's important to pray. I don't ever come up here behind this pulpit, but I haven't prayed on a Sunday morning every day, every Sunday morning praying for this service even today. But see, this is not the only place of prayer. Prayer starts in your house. Yes, amen. Prayer starts in this house, in your house, your physical house, the one you got built. But most important, prayer starts in this house. Amen. We are the temple of the living God. You are a house of prayer. Good Lord, don't let me get on that. Come on. You want Jesus to come in here with a whip and start running out everything in you that ain't right? Come on. He goes into his house of prayer and he gets rid of everything that ain't like him. Amen. If we're not praying, if we're not praying, come on. He'll Jesus get that whip out and he'll start, hey, look at this. Woo! He wants you to be a house of prayer. Yeah, we are the temple of the living God. Houses of prayer. Praying for one another. Interceding. God builds his house on prayer. Can I get another amen? Amen. And then we got to learn to pray like this, just like Jesus did. Jesus said, Father, not my will, but thine be done. Oh, yes. Now think about that for me. That's what Jesus is praying. He says, Father, not my will, thy will be done. Now, if it's possible, Jesus is praying back. See, prayer is just communicating with God, y'all, with the Father. That's what prayer is. We're just communicating. Now, Jesus, this is what he said. He says, Father, if it's possible, remove this cup. Think about that for a minute. He says, remove this cup. There is a this cup experience. Oh, Lord, help me now. There is a this cup experience for every one of us. See, we think Jesus has done it all. We ain't supposed to do nothing. Oh, good Lord, help me, Lord, get this thing through. Can I just say this? You can't wear the crown unless you drink the cup. Let me say that one more time. You can't wear the crown unless you're willing to drink the cup. Amen. Jesus sitting by the right hand of the Father, the Lamb of God, he paid the price. He drank the cup, amen? He drank the ultimate cup. He took all of our sins that was in that cup. He took it all. He took it all upon himself, one who knew no sin. But I'm here to tell you, we all got a this cup experience. We've got a this cup that we've got to learn to get in our hand. It ain't the, come on, Lord, it ain't the cup of this world. It's the cup of Jesus. See, we want the blessings of the Lord, but we don't want to pay the price. Golly, I didn't get an amen whatsoever. We want God to bless us. We don't want to pay the price. God bless me, you keep the cup. Lord bless me, but I'm not going through no suffering. You can forget about it. Lord bless me, but I'm not going through that. I don't want to go through it. It's not for me. Who said it wasn't for you? Who told us that we're not going to suffer if we live for the Lord? Who told us sometimes we're not going to go through some things, y'all? Who told us that? God don't say that. Church, let me just, I'm trying to get you prepared, get you ready. Sometimes we suffer serving the Lord. Amen. Suffering, but what is suffering though? See, what we think suffering is so bad, it's so awful, it ain't good, I don't want it. But Paul said, he'd rather suffer for the Lord. Paul suffered, my Lord, he was ready to suffer. And when he went through persecution and suffering, guess what? He just began to praise the Lord. That's our problem today. All the time we think we can praise the Lord is when we're on the mountain. We ought to learn to praise the Lord when we think we're going through suffering. But you know what? We ought to count it as all done. Good Lord. It don't mean nothing no way, Lord. One day this is going to be over. One day I'm going to be with you in heaven. Hallelujah. Lord, one day you paid the price. You said it's finished. All I got to do is, through this suffering, learn to praise you, to worship you, to glorify you, to give you the praise, the glory, and the honor that's due his name. Good Lord. If Jesus suffered for us the way he did, can't we suffer a little bit for him? Can't we go through something for him? Can't we take a little bit of persecution sometimes? Come on. Can't we just have a blessed spirit? And I said, good Lord, I'm praising you. If somebody is cussing us out or don't even like us, why do we take things so personal? Maybe you're going through what you're going through for somebody else. Maybe somebody else needs to see how you're going to react when you're going through. Come on. Maybe somebody needs a witness, somebody who's real, somebody who can go through some suffering and still give God the praise, the glory, and the honor. Can I get an amen up in here? Jesus never turned his back on the Father. Why do we think we need to start turning our back on the Father when it's not going the way we want it to go? Oh, this is a hard message, but it's going to be a good message in our spirit. Amen. We think everything's got to be the way we want it. And it's not always the way we want it. That's why Jesus said, Father, not my will, your will be done. I really don't want to drink this cup, Father, but there's no other way. I'm going to drink it. Lord, I don't really want to go through this, but if I have to, I'm going through because somebody might need to see a witness and a testimony in me. Somebody needs to see your goodness, your mercy, your grace. Come on. Somebody needs to see your mighty power, your mighty strength. Somebody needs to see that you can deliver because you are a delivering God. Somebody help me up in here. People need to see something real. Good Lord. It's when you're going through and you can praise God that it's wonderful. That's a testimony. That's a witness. Jesus, Lord, if not, I'm going to do what you want me to do. We want the fame and the glory. But Lord, you keep that cup of suffering. I've come to the conclusion, I don't care about no kind of fame or glory with man. People don't even know what they're asking for a lot of times. People love the praise of men more than the praise of God. I don't want men praising me. I want God praising me. I don't want no man bragging on me if God ain't bragging on me. Somebody help me up in here. Don't you want God to brag on you? It don't matter what men think. It don't matter what a man or woman thinks about you. What we got to be concerned is, Lord, what do you think about me? Lord, what does your heart say about me? How do you look? Oh, Lord, what do you think about Roy? What do you think about Gail? What do you think about Billy Joe? What do you think about Stan? Lord, what do you think about Ken? What do you think about Stephanie? What do you think about Dustin? What do you think about Paul? What do you think about Annette? Lord, what do you think about that beautiful woman named Dana? Come on, y'all. What does God think about us? What does God think about us? Thank you, brother. What does God think about me and you? How do we react when we get in a certain place? How do we act when somebody comes against us? What comes out of our mouth? What come out of the mouth of Jesus when opposition come against him? Oh, somebody help me up in here. Ooh, can I get amen, y'all? Come on, somebody help me. See, we want fame and glory, but I'd rather have fame in God's eyes. Let me tell you this, y'all. The greater the trial, the greater the blessing. Amen. Are you willing to go through what you're going through because God's got a tremendous blessing for you? Do you see what Joseph went through, y'all, before he got to the palace? Because God had such a calling on that young man's life. He paid the price. He went through. He just went through trusting God. See, some of us go through some hard places because God's got a great blessing in store. Oh, he wants to bless your socks off. He's already blessed mine off. Look. Hallelujah. Ooh, thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. He done blessed my socks off. Praise God. He'll bless your socks off too. Praise God. He'll bless you continuously. He's a good God. He's an awesome God, church. So through the trial, through the agony, through the suffering, Jesus said this. Your will be done. Church, can we say this? Through all the storms of life, through all the hurts and all the pains, yes, can we say, Father, your will be done, not mine? Amen. I mean, even as a minister, can we say, Father, your will be done, not mine? Yes, everybody in here, can you say, Father, not my will, but your will be done in my life? Whatever I got to go through, Lord, I know you're there to give me the grace and the mercy. See, sometimes we pray for God's grace and mercy, and we think God's just going to put it on some kind of platter and say, here you go, eat it up. We think that's how grace and mercy comes. Let me tell you, grace and mercy don't come on a platter. Grace and mercy comes through the cup. Comes through that cup we're talking about. Grace and mercy comes when you're going through something that don't feel good. How could you ever experience God's grace and mercy if you never needed it? Y'all, I need his grace and mercy every day. Amen. We need his grace and mercy. And whatever you have to go through, he will give you the grace and mercy to get you through it. No kind of temptation will come upon you that's uncommon to man. Come on. Whatever you're going through, God will give you the grace and the mercy to get through it. It ain't going to destroy you. It ain't going to take you apart. Come on. I promise you, what it's going to do is make you stronger. It's going to make you like a piece of gold. It's going to make you like a diamond. I believe there's some gold nuggets up in here now. I believe there's some diamonds up in here. God's working on all of us. Amen. He's going to make some diamonds and some gold nuggets out of a bunch of us in here if we'll just learn, Lord, I thank you for your grace. I thank you for your mercy. I ain't talking about that person. I ain't talking about them. All I'm going to do is pray for them, Lord. You get a hold of them. You touch them, Father. We're going to put them in your hands. Somebody help me up in here. And Lord, what I'm going to do, I'm going to trust you. Hallelujah. Because you are a merciful God. You are a grateful God. Oh, your mercy and your grace. Your mercy and your grace, Father. Lord, I thank you, Father. I praise you. For there's none like you. None like him, church. We get to a place where we think God really ain't in control. God's in control of everything. He is. He's in control of everything. He's holding this earth in the middle of nothing by the word of his mouth. He spoke a word over you. That's why you in the place you in right now. You wouldn't even know him if he didn't speak a word and didn't put it in your heart. Come on, someone help me up in here. And he's holding you and he's keeping you. But he's trying to teach us. It's more than just being saved. It's more than just being cleansed by the blood. It's more than just being filled with the Spirit of God. We got to get to a place where we're not babies no more. We're not teenagers no more. But we're mature adults. Come on, y'all. That we can trust God no matter what we're going through. We can give God the praise in everything. Because we know, God, you're in control of my life. Not me no more. I can't control my life. God, you control my life. You're in control. Hallelujah. You're leading and guiding every step that I take. Oh, church, come on. Every step you take is being ordered of you. See, that's the place God is trying to get us to. Not having to put bottles in our mouth all the time. Come on. Doubting God because he's not doing it the way we thought he would do it. He don't never do it the way you think he's going to do it. Never. So through all of it, y'all, through the hurts and the pain, Father, your will be done, not mine. Everything in our life, church, every relationship has to be not my will, but thy will be done. Oh, boy, that got quiet. Every relationship, every part of our life, Father, not my will, your will be done. You get messed up when you do your own thing. Come on. We get messed up. We follow the lust of our flesh and the lust of our eyes and the pride of life, which are worldly things, instead of doing it God's way. Lord, don't let me get caught up in the lust of my eyes, the lust of my flesh. Father, let me do it your way. Your will, Father. Your will, Father. Your will, Father. Your will. You see what I'm saying? Your will, Father. How many people, men and women both, has got messed up because of the lust of their eyes and the lust of their flesh? Yes. Thinking, oh, that's so beautiful, that's so wonderful, I sure would like to have that. And then when they get a hold of it, they found out it wasn't what they thought it was. Come on, when they got a hold of it, they said, oh, my Lord, what have I done now? What kind of mess have I got myself into? Well, come on, y'all, King David got himself in a mess, didn't he? Yes. Up on that rooftop, got some lust in his eyes. Seen a beautiful woman, wanted that woman. Let that lust take over his heart and mind. And all of a sudden, here he is with a woman, Bathsheba, another man's wife. You think that was God's will? No, it wasn't God's will. It was David's will. It's what he wanted. Come on. He got into a mess when he took Bathsheba, took her to himself. Got in such a mess, he didn't realize the woman was going to get pregnant. How many of your sins will find you out? Your sins will find you out. The woman got pregnant. He tried to cover it up by even murdering her husband. You see what lust can do? When you let it just start a little bit, caused him to murder this woman's husband because he thought he could cover his sin. He was doing a pretty good job covering that sin among the people until this prophet of the Lord came up called Nathan. He said, David, boy, and I'm paraphrasing, but he said, boy, you done messed up. God sees what you done and he ain't pleased with it. And he paid a hard price for that job. Why? Because David did his will instead of the will of the Father. God had given that man so much. Why do we do that, church? God has given us so much. Look what he's given us. Roy, look what he's given you. A beautiful wife named Gail. Hallelujah. Don't need nobody else. See what I'm saying? Stan, God's give you a beautiful wife, Esther. And what a beautiful name, Esther, in the Bible. She's in the Bible. Hallelujah. Come on. You see what I'm saying? Somebody help me up in here. Why do we want something else when look what God has done? Dustin, God's given you a lovely, beautiful wife, Stephanie. Beautiful, ain't she? Y'all look at her. She's beautiful. And she could sing too. Good Lord, like an angel. Hallelujah. See what God has done, how God has blessed us tremendously. But like David, we get into a mess sometimes. Come on. Getting something we don't need. Now, God can make good out of a mess, but why go through all of that? Why lose something in your life? Why? I mean, good Lord, David paid a hard price for that, y'all. The sword stayed in his family for the rest of his life. God wouldn't deliver, wouldn't set it free, you know. He had cousins, lost a child, lost a lot of stuff. Had rapes in his family, sons raping daughters. Can you imagine? Because of what David did. See, we think our sins just affect us. No, it affects everybody. So that's why I'm telling you, church, we've got to, Lord, what's your will in this situation? You know, if David had said, Lord, is it your will for me to go to Bathsheba? Guess what? It wasn't his will. He wouldn't have went. And everybody says, what about the lineage that come through that? What about the lineage? God could have done that any way he wanted to. It didn't have to be done through sin. Everybody thinks they got to sin for God's love, for God to do something. No, you don't do that. Amen. We don't sin for God to turn that thing around and make it better. Amen. We don't sin. We just say, look, here I am, Lord. I'm not sin. I'm not going to sin so God can turn that thing around. We don't need to do that. We need to do what God wants us to do. Amen. And then let God do what, and he'll do what he wants to do. He can take a mess and turn it around. But why make him do that? He don't want to do that. He wants to do it right the first time. Can I get another amen? Amen. We're almost through. Y'all with me? So it says, Father, not your will, not my will, but your will be done. Everything in our life, y'all, everything has to be done by God's will. I only want your will, Father, in my life. When we get to that place, y'all, I promise you, that's when the answer will come. The safest place for you and me is in the will of the Father. The safest place you can possibly be, church, is in the will of the Father. That's why we say today, Father, not your will. Father, not my will, but your will be done. Can we stand on our feet and give God a big old clap of praise? Come on, church. Come on. Not a long message today. Come on. Come on, church. Come on, come on. Come on, come on. Let's give God some praise. Come on, come on, come on.